Hello everyone, I am Vibha Chahan and welcome to Jai Hind Classes Funda Clear. So today I will explain class 8 history chapter 3. Chapter is ruling the countryside. So what do you mean by this heading, ruling the countryside? It means that, as you know, that Britishers came in India for the purpose of trade and they were trading in cities. But how they control over countryside, over village area, how they trade over village area, we will discuss in this chapter. We will discuss about the problems, about the systems that were bought by Britishers, about the Blue Rebellion. So what are the topics of this chapter? The topics of this chapter are: the company becomes Diwan, crops for Europe, the Blue Rebellion and after. The company becomes Diwan. So, after the Battle of Buxar on 12 August 1765, the Mughal Emperor of Delhi, Shah Alam II, appointed the company as a Diwan of Bengal. Company means East India Company, or you can say Britishers. So, Diwan means that they had right to collect revenue. And it also meant that they had to administer the province of Bengal. They had to do work in the welfare of people of Bengal. They had to organize facilities for peasants, for artisans of Bengal. They had to do many works in the welfare of Bengal. And after getting the Diwan right, the company became the financial power, financial administrator of the Bengal. And after some years, they also felt that they had to pacify with local rulers, with the rulers who had governed over the Bengal. So they had to pacify with it. And how did they pacify? How did they do all the work? We will see. Revenue for the company. So, after getting the Diwani rights, Britishers still was considering them as a trader. They came in India only for the purpose of getting money. So after getting the Diwani rights, they were not doing their work. They were only focusing on money. They were only focusing on revenue. But from that revenue, they were not administering the people of Bengal. They were not doing works in welfare of people of Bengal. So they were not doing their work properly. They wanted that money for buying goods from India, for buying silk cloth, cotton cloth at very, very cheaper prices. Because before that Diwani right, they used gold and silver, which was imported from Britain, to buy goods from India. But after getting the Diwani rights, the flow of gold and silver from Britain was entirely stopped because they were using that money for buying the goods from India. And due to this, peasants of India, artisans of India suffered a great loss. Villages were desiring, artisans' work was completely declining. Peasants' agriculture was collapsing. So this was problem with the revenue which was collected by the Britishers. And in 1770, a terribly famine took the life of 10 million people, which was about 1/3 of the population of Bengal, and which was wiped out. So due to this famine, many people died. So due to this revenue system, people of Bengal had suffered so much. So the next is the need to improve agriculture. As I've discussed that due to revenue systems of Britishers, due to revenue, the peasants, the people of Bengal were suffering so much. There was deep crisis in Bengal. So for this, the company officials thought that they had to do something on it. They had to increase them in the land, in improving the land. So after 2 decades, that means 20 years, on debating this question, on debate after debate on this question, a new system was introduced in 1793, which was permanent settlement. And according to this permanent settlement, it was that the local Rajas and Tukaldas who governed the Tukals, which was divided in history. So according to this permanent settlement, the local Rajas and local Tukaldas had to act like Zamindars. The Britishers had considered them as Zamindars. And they had to collect revenue from people. They was appointed by the Britishers to collect revenue from peasants, because peasants were the main source of collecting revenue at that time. So they had to collect revenue from peasants, and there was a fixed amount by Britishers which had to be given from the Zamindars to the Britishers, which was from revenue, and it was fixed. There could not be more or less. And Britishers had appointed them as Zamindars because they wanted to Zamindars investigate to improve the land quality of farmers, of the peasants of that time. So this was the permanent settlement. So there were many problems with it. What was that problems? The problem. So as I said, that the amount of fixed charge could not be more or less. And the amount of fixed charge was very high to pay by the Zamindars. And Zamindars thought it was very hard to pay that amount to Britishers. They said that it was very hard, they could not. And due to this, their Zamindaris were sold out, their lands were sold out. So this was the problem. And another problem was also, and after some time, the agriculture in Bengal flourished, and due to this, Zamindars got much revenue from the people, from the peasants. But Britishers had no profit with it, because the fixed charge was fixed, amount was fixed, and there was no profit to it. So there was a problem for Britishers. In first problem, it was for Zamindars, and in second, it was for Britishers. And there was also another problem, it was for peasants. People, peasants, artisans were oppressed with it from the starting of this permanent settlement. They were opposed in this, they were in opposed of this, because it was not right, because it was very high revenue to pay. As a peasant is can't pay, as a peasant could not pay that high revenue, and he had to borrow money from money lenders. So these were the problems with it. And what was the solution? So our next topic is the new system is devised. As I discussed that there were many problems with permanent settlement, Britishers were not getting profit with it. So for this, they had made a new system, they had made a new settlement, and that was Mahalwali system. And it was imposed on northwestern parts of Bengal, and nowadays most of them are in Uttar Pradesh. So it was devised in 1822 by Holt Mackenzie. And in this system, it was that the villagers had to pay revenue. Collectors went village to village and investigated the fields and reported the fields, checked the quality of fields, fertility of fields, and by this Britishers had estimated a revenue for a village, for every village, and that was revenue for whole village that was collected by village headman from the peasants of village, and he had to give that money to the Britishers as a revenue. So in this system, it was that the main role had to played by village headman, and in the permanent settlement, it was Zamindar. So this is a difference between them, and it is called as Mahalwali system because Britishers considered village as a mahal, because it was important for revenue, and it was also like a mahal. So that's why it is called as Mahalwari system. So it was the whole about the new system is devised. So our next subtopic is the Munro system. As these settlements, these systems were imposed on northern part of India, but in southern part of India there were also settlements, there were also system, and it also refused for permanent settlement. There was another settlement which was Munro system, and it was imposed by Captain Alexander Reed in small area, in a small scale, and he imposed only in the areas which was conquered from the Mysore, from the Tipu Sultan. So he imposed only in that areas, but after that some time, but after some years, Thomas Munro, who was governor of Madras from 1819 to 1826, developed it and imposed it on the whole southern part of India, on whole British conquered area. So according to this Munro system, it was that the revenue had to be collected directly from the ryots. Ryots were who cultivated crops, cultivated something, cultivated anything. So they were ryots, and according to this, the revenue had to be collected directly from them, because Captain Alexander Reed and Thomas Munro both felt that there were no traditional zamindars in the southern part of India, and Munro also felt that they should be act as parental father to the peasants. So this was all about the Munro system. Next subtopic is all was not well. After imposing these settlements, after the arrival of the settlements, these systems, after some years of their settlements, the situation was not well. The situation was very bad. Peasants were unable to pay revenue, that high revenue. Ryots were fled. Villages were desiring, villages were being empty, people were going another place, going to live another place, going to city. Peasants were not doing their work properly, were not doing agriculture, they were doing something else. Artisans were also in loss, artisans work was also in decline. So because of these settlements, due to these settlements, these systems, there were many problems. The situation was not well. People were suffering so much. So this was the whole topic, the company becomes Diwan. So our next topic is crops for Europe, and its subtopics are: does color have a history? Why the demand for Indian indigo? Britain turns to India. How was indigo cultivated? The problem with niche cultivation indigo on the land of Ryots. So crops for Europe. The Britishers also realized that the countryside could not only yield the revenue, that means they could not get only the revenue from the countryside. They realized that they could get crops from countryside which Europe required, which Europe needed. So from countryside they wanted to get crops as much as can be. And by the 18th century, the Britishers focused to expand the cultivation of opium and indigo. However, in the century and half that was followed, they expanded many crops, they focused on many crops, just like, for example, jute in Bengal, sugarcane in United Provinces, cotton in Maharashtra and Punjab, wheat in Punjab, rice in Madras. So these were the crops that were grown by cultivators for Britishers. And the Britishers used variety of methods to expand the cultivation, and we will take a closer look of such an example. Does color have a history? So question is this, that does color have a history? Yes, all things in the world has history, everything has a history, and color also has a history. and it is saying about indigo. We will study indigo in this chapter about indigo. So it is saying indigo. Indigo was a dye which was in blue color, which was very popular at that time. And at that time, India was the biggest exporter of it, because in India it was grown. So at that time, India was the biggest exporter of it, and indigo was also popular at that time very much, as there were no synthetic dyes and it was a natural dye which was in blue color. Why the demand for Indian indigo? So indigo was a plant which was only grown in tropics. Tropical region mean the region between the Tropic of Cancer and Tropic of Capricorn. So it was a plant which was only grown in tropics, but the Europe was in temperate zone, so there could not be grown indigo. But the demand for dyes were very high in Europe, in Britain, but the supply of indigo in Britain was very low, hence its price was very high. And the cloth dyers, the cultivators grown another plant named woad. Woad was a different kind of dye which was also in blue color, which could be grown in temperate zones, which could be grown in Britain. So they grown woad. But the grown cultivators found that there would be competition if indigo would supplied in Britain, and there would be meant much competition for them for their earnings. So they pressurized government and made ban on the indigo supplies. So after that, all the supply of indigo from any country stopped in Britain, and they only used woad. But the cloth dyers who dyed clothes preferred indigo much than woad, because woad gave a pale and dull kind of version in comparison to indigo, gave a very bright contrast. So that's why the cloth dyers preferred indigo. And by the 17th century, again cloth dyers pressurized the government and removed the ban from the indigo. And there was so much demand for indigo dye in clothes, so the government removed the ban for indigo supplies. But as the demand for the indigo increased, the supplies of indigo decreased, because by the 1783 to 1789, the production of indigo fell to the half, because America and West Indies production of indigo and supplies to Britain was completely collapsed. And there were many factors, there were many reasons, there was not only one factor that why it collapsed. And by 1783 to 1789, the indigo production fell to the half. But the cloth manufacturers, cloth dyers of Britain wanted indigo as a dye, so they had to procure it from somewhere. And from where did they procure? Britain turns to India. So as I discussed that cloth dyers of Britain wanted dye of indigo, because indigo was much better than woad. So why did they want indigo? Why did they want dyed cloth? Because in Britain there was increasing industrialization. They were developing industries of cotton, of textile. So they wanted to dye clothes. So for this they wanted indigo. And from the last decades of 18th century, the cultivation of indigo expanded in Bengal, and the company wanted to expand the area under the indigo cultivation. So many company officials, many Scotsmen, many Englishmen came to India, lefting all their business, lefting all their places, lefting all their families, came to India and became planters. Planters were those who cultivated indigo cultivation, who did indigo cultivation. So planters came to India from Britain, who were before officials, company officials. And after the arrival of planters in India, the cultivation of indigo was much expanded, as it can be shown. For example, in 1788, the supply of indigo from India to Britain was only 30%. It means that the whole supply to India, it means that the whole supply to Britain, in which there was 30% of India's. But in 1810, it increased to 95%. So this was the increased proportion. And the planters who had no money for cultivation took loans for banks as it was rising at that time. So next subtopic is, how was indigo cultivated? So as the planters came in India for indigo cultivation, so question is this, how was indigo cultivated? What was the method of cultivation? Indigo. So basically there were two methods. One was Nis cultivation and other was Ryoti system, Ryoti cultivation. So in Nis cultivation, planters bought or rented land from other zamindars, and on it they cultivated indigo with their employed hired workers or laborers. So from those workers or laborers, planters got their indigo, and in return they gave them salary or rent to the workers. So this was the niche cultivation, but there were many problems with it. What were the problems? The problem with niche cultivation. So as I said that there were many problems with niche cultivations. There was not only one problem, there were many. And what were those problems? One of these problems were that it was very hard to find land for planters, to find fertile land. And the fertile land they got or rented or bought was very densely populated, highly populated. So there was a problem to cultivate on fertile land on which was densely or highly populated. So one of these problems were to get land, to get fertile land. And if they get land fertile, that was very far away from factory, that was very far away from peasants, and they wanted to get a land near a factory where they got facilities from. So this was a problem. And another problem was also there, which was to hire laborers, to hire peasants to work in the fields, to work in the lands, because without them there would not be any cultivation. So there was a problem because peasants were busy in their own rice cultivations and they were not coming with planters to cultivate indigo in their fields. And they were busy in their own rice cultivation. So this was another problem. And another problem was also there, which was plugs and bullocks. For cultivation, there was a need of plugs and bullocks, because at that time there were not any tractors, and nowadays we use tractors for cultivation. But at that time, farmers or peasants used the plugs and bullocks. So there was also a lack of plugs and bullocks, and planters could not hire it, could not buy it, and peasants were not giving them because they were busy at their own rice cultivation. So this was another problem. So these all were the problems with niche cultivation which had to be faced by planters. In niche cultivation, there were problems only for planters. There were no problems for peasants because they were working their own. So for this, a new system of cultivation was developed by planters, which was Ryoti cultivation. So our next subtopic is indigo on the land of Ryots. As I've said that the new system was developed, which was Ryoti cultivation. So under this Ryoti system, under this Ryoti cultivation system, peasants had to sign a contract with planters in which it was that they had to grow indigo in on their own fields, and for that they got advance cash from planters, and for this they grown indigo on their own lands. And it was also in that contract that planters had to give only seeds and drills, but the whole hard work was done by farmers. So this was the Ryoti system, and planters asked the village headman on behalf of village to contract sign for all peasants. So this was the Ryoti system, and there were problems with it too. And in this system, there was problems for peasants, there were problems for farmers, and in niche cultivation system, there were problems for planters. And what were the problems in Ryoti system? It was decided that planters had to grow indigo on 25% of their land, and they had to grow it on the best soil, best fertile soil of land where they used to grow rice. And after the cultivation of indigo, there was a problem. What was that problem? That problem was that the roots of indigo was very deep, and due to it the fertile soil got exhausted, and after that rice cultivation could not be done. So that was the problem. And another problem was also there, which was that after an harvest of indigo, peasants gave all the indigo to the planters, but after that planters again gave them cash advance, and due to it a cycle of loan was created, and once peasant was trapped in that, they could never get out. So this was another problem with Ryoti system. So the next and last topic of this chapter is the Blue Rebellion and after. Blue Rebellion. What do you mean by Blue Rebellion? Blue Rebellion means it was rebelled for blue, for indigo, against indigo. So that's why it is called as Blue Rebellion. So as I've said that there were many problems with Ryoti systems. So in 1859, in March, the Ryots rebelled against the planters. They attacked on factories of planters armed with spears, bows, arrows and swords, and the women also attacked on factories with pots, with pans, with other kitchen implements. So they attacked on factories against planters, they rebelled in 1859. And the Gomasthas were also beaten up. Gomasthas were the people who came to collect rent from the peasants by the side of planters. So the Gomasthas were beaten up by the peasants, by the Ryots. And the Ryots completely refused to grow indigo on their lands because there were many problems I have discussed. So they refused to grow indigo on their land. They refused to pay the rent and they rebelled. So question is this. So why did they rebel in 1859? Why not before? Why not later? Why in 1859? What was the reason behind this? Because the British government was already worried about with the Great Revolt of 1857, which was very harsh for them, for the Britishers. So they were worried about 1857's revolt. So that's why they saw that there was a good opportunity for them to report. And they also got the support of village headman and zamindars. Village headman supported them because they were unpleasant, because they were unhappy that they had to sign contract with planters. Planters forced them to sign contract. So village headman supported the riots of these villages, and zamindars also supported them because they were unhappy with the increasing powers of planters. At that time planters were increasing power, so that's the reason why they rebelled in 1859. And the British government was already worried about it, so they thought to do something. And after the news of rebel, the lieutenant governor toured the region of Bengal, and after seeing that, the riots thought that this was the sign to rebel, that they had sympathy for them, that the British government had sympathy for the riots against the planters. So they thought to rebel. Their rebelling power was increasing, and there was also misinterpretation of that. What was that? The magistrate Ashley Adams took out a notice in which it was written that the riots would not be compelled for to sign contract. So after seeing this, the riots thought that this was a sign to rebel, but Ashley Adams wrote that notice because to palisade peasants, to palisade riots, he wanted to solve that matter. He wanted peace, but it was against that. It was completely failed, and the rebel was started. So after the rebel was started, the intellectuals from Calcutta wrote many things about the horrible of indigo, about the tannery of peasants. So they wrote all things by poetry, by writings, by stories, by plays from Calcutta. So this was the rebel. And what was after? What happened after the rebellion? After the rebellion, Britain sent its military force, its army, not to against peasants, but to assault their planters, but to save their planters from peasants. And after that, a community was set up to handle that matter. And the community found the planters guilty and criticized them for coercive methods with planters, with peasants, which would be liked by both sides. And they also said that peasants must carry on the existing contract, but they could refuse it in future. That means the indigo was grown in any peasant's land, then he had to give it to planters because it was existing matter, because it was existing deals. So the community handled that matter through that, like that. And after the rebel, the business of indigo in Bengal completely collapsed, completely, because there was a rebel. And after that, it was shifted to Bihar. It was shifted, it was transferred to Bihar by planters. They were doing their indigo plantations there in Bihar. And the arrival of new synthetic dyes had affected the business of planters, because people were buying most of the synthetic dyes. There was no need, there was less need of natural dyes. But they carried on their business, and yet they were doing business in Bihar. And in 1970, a new movement was starting, which was Champaran Andolan, which was led by Mahatma Gandhi, which we will read in further classes or next classes. So this was the whole topic, this was the whole chapter. Our chapter is completed. I have discussed all topics, and in next video I will discuss next chapter. So thank you very much.